Okay, we, Finance Committee is in session. We have minutes from April 4.
Yep.
You've got some minutes, April 4.
How are you, John? Good. Doing well, thanks.
Any discussion?
I wasn't sure whether or not I got the two-vote thing correct.
That's the extra one.
Who needs the warrant?
I do.
We all do. But this one doesn't, so. Okay. Are there any corrections? Any discussion? Could I have a motion?
I motion. Make motion to move the minutes of April 4th.
It's moved, seconded.
Second.
It's moved, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Let's see, the 11th, right?
What I thought we'd do tonight is we'll go through the warrant. And where we have, there are a couple items on there that we need to take some votes on. But at least you can see what's there. And as we go through the items, we'll pick out the ones that we need to vote on. Article 1, there's nothing there for us to do. Article 2 is the salaries for elected officials. This is something that we typically voted on.
I think we've already voted on.
But I thought they were going to add more to the moderators. No?
We added another 50 to the moderator in case we had another special.
Special town meeting.
Correct.
So we did increase the budget.
It's on the next line, I'm sorry.
Well, it's also in the budget, too. And we, I think we put 400 in the budget, I'm not sure.
Yes, that's correct.
So we can do two special town meetings if we need to. Okay, can I have a motion on these?
Total.
But, yeah, that's the budget. This is the actual salaries that we're voting or the recommended.
You have an account number, Brenda? Do you know, off the top of your head?
What's that?
For the moderator, it's the top one, 114-5100.
They're all different.
And then for the selectmen's salaries, it's the next one down, 122-5100.
Never mind.
Oh, okay.
I was hoping it'd be one, but
no.
Yeah. And I don't know about the school committee. That would be the one.
It's in their budget.
It would have to be in their budget, but that's one that I did not verify.
Those are the correct amounts.
But this is not what we recommended.
Yes, it is.
Not on these.
Yeah. Well, which one would you like to look at?
Selectmen salaries.
Go ahead.
So selectmen, each associate gets 5,000, so that would be 10,000, and then the chair gets 6,000, so that would add.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. And so, what about associates? Isn't there in a different account?
And then the assessors are in 141-5100, and that total should be 8,000. Yeah.
We did vote 400 for.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's per. Okay. Yeah. Never mind. Got it.
Okay. Great.
Race.
Yay, thank you.
Whoops.
Okay, can I have a motion? Motion to, we've got a motion, is there a second?
I'll second it after all that.
Pardon?
I'll second it.
Okay, it's moved and seconded. All those in favor of the, favor of recommending Article 2?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous? Article 4, that's the Dickinson Library Trust. Brenda, what's the breakdown on that?
85% to Tilton Library and 15% to Frontier. So it amounts to $892 for Tilton Library and $158 for Frontier.
Make a motion to approve that.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's moved, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So that's a 7-0. Number five, to see if the town will vote to amend the Town of Deerfield general bylaws. I don't know that we need to vote this. If you want to, we can, but would you explain, briefly explain the article?
This is to be in compliance with the Municipal Modernization Act, correct? Yes, it was a change in how you vote on revolving funds. The motion will have the amounts and the box and all of that that you're used to voting on. And do you have that?
I don't have those details.
Okay.
Okay, so this is just the article, the motion, which is really what we would need.
Will be consistent with what you've been doing.
I don't foresee any changes from what we voted last year at annual town meeting. I'm not aware of any extra 53E and a halves that we would be voting.
Okay. So we'll pass over Article 5. Article 6, this is to fund the police contract for the current year based on, pardon?
Motion to support that.
Okay, and that's based on the negotiations and the, so the contract's been signed, it's sealed, it's delivered. We really don't have much choice. We need money from someplace. So could I have a motion on this?
Make a motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Well, either John or Mary made the motion, and so if there's no further discussion. Now, this is...
Why don't we take this out of reserves? Is it too much? Or is it not unforeseen?
We could have...
Well, no, it's okay. We could have done, we could have done that. We talked about it. We just decided we'd take it out of...
Because of the amount, it's a little easier to take it to town meeting.
Okay.
Because we don't know what might still come up that we need the reserve fund for.
And one way or the other, whatever's not used goes into general funds. So. Okay, so this is for the FY 17, the current fiscal year. It's not for...
And we'll have to make sure that's in the motion.
So all of those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? So it's voted 7-0-0. What was... That's right, Jack. Okay. 6-0-1. Sorry. And this is what's needed in the budget to cover the police salary. What was the total?
I believe John thought that the difference between what we had voted at annual town meeting last year and what the contract ended up being was about $35,000.
Okay. So that, I think, you
well,
asked
the
question.
Well, I asked what the annual percentage per person was.
I don't know.
The raise.
I don't know that figure.
It depends on, you know, Quinn bill and all that.
Without the Quinn bill, they must have all got the same amount of money as a raise. Then well, some would automatically get
I can go bill. Get it and bring it back while you're talking about it.
Okay. I'm just curious. Just like to know at some point.
Public information.
Okay, the next one will take a few minutes. Classification schedule. Let me pass it out. I've got several things here. The top one the classification schedule that's been proposed. On the next page would be the classification schedule. Let me point out, there are a couple of things here that we need to take account of. If you look at grade 3, step 10, that's what an employee will be paid next year in that graded step. We have an employee right now who's making $27.35. So that was one of the constraints that we were up against when we put the salary schedule together. That employee is going to get $27.35 next year.
Plus longevity.
Plus whatever longevity is.
So they're grade something step 10 right now.
They are.
We have been for a long time.
Yes. We have two employees who I believe this year are grade six, step eight. They're making a slightly different amount from what's there. They will be moving to grade six, step nine next year, and grade 10 the year after. So $37.55 is what they're both going to be paid next year. So within that, we had that constraint in putting this salary schedule together. And that's the reason for the so-called 5%. This is so-called 5%, but you can... It isn't 5% everywhere. It just starts at about 5% and goes across. I've taken the same constraints, just for your information, and on the next page, you'll see so-called classification schedule 2.5%. There is approximately what we would have needed to do in order to do a 2.5% in ten steps.
And you work from step 10 backwards.
I work from step 10 backwards.
Yep.
And the same one, and in this case, they are all 2.5% increases over the prior step.
Yep.
So, and then a classification schedule with a 4% increase. Same deal. Started with step 10 and worked backwards. So you can see in one case, the proposed classification schedule starts at $13 an hour. 4% would have been $13.70 an hour. 2.5% increases would have been $15.61 per hour. And I don't believe that the employees who are sitting at step eight this year, they would continue to move to step nine. I could be correct, I may be wrong on that, but I think they both would end up moving to step nine. But we can look and take a look. If not, they would be sitting at step.
Yeah, I think it's there.
At step seven, step eight.
Well, in between.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
I just did that for your, you know, edification so you could see it. What I also wanted you to take a look at, you've got the teacher's contract for the current year, for next year, and the year after. And I didn't bother going through on this one and calculating the percentages, but they roughly is about just a little over a 3% increase. So grade 3 to grade 4, bachelors, they're all about the same, roughly 3%. I will point out that when you drop down to grade 13 and go from 13 to 14, it's an 8% increase.
So I thought the contract, when we discussed it, there was a 1% raise the first year. Which contract is this?
That's this one. Yeah. This one represents.
This is how.
And then 3%.
2.5.
2.5 for the next 2 years.
2.5, right.
So this one is 1% higher than last year's contract. It has a COLA in it of 1% above last year. So last year's would have been in the neighborhood of $41,200.
So it's a COLA increase.
It is a COLA increase. And next year's contract, July 1st, 2017 to 2018, is the existing contract plus a cost of living of 2.5%. So it has a COLA of 2.5%. And the same for the year after. That's a COLA of 2.5%. So approximately, over a three-year period, it's a 6% COLA, roughly 2% each year, broken up a little differently. Plus the steps, which are 3%.
And they're automatic steps?
They're automatic steps.
Just like this town.
They're automatic steps. And the only way you don't get them is if you get fired.
Okay.
And you have an opportunity to move across. So if you started with a bachelor's degree, a bachelor's plus 15, that's a bachelor's degree and 15 credits. And it doesn't really say where those 15 credits, get them anywhere you want. And then the master's degree, you do have to get a master's degree.
Who pays for the education?
I believe the employee does.
Okay.
There may be I don't know, I haven't read the contracts recently. A lot of contracts will pay for one course.
Yeah, or something.
Right, per year.
Yeah. And in some cases, I mean, the teachers are required, and I don't know what the breakdown is, to do continuing education. This covers the continuing education. So if you take a course, you can use it to the continuing ed credits.
Right.
That you have to do, and I don't know whether it's a three-year or a five-year period, but there's so many continuing ed credits.
Credits can be applied.
In 3 to 5 years.
Which will help them move across to the next column.
In many cases, the schools actually run programs in the schools. But for example, and I don't know, essentially teachers are more or less required to obtain a master's degree at some point in their first 5 or 6 years of teaching, if they didn't already have one. And again, after you've got the master's degree, you can take 5 more courses for a master's plus 15. And it doesn't necessarily mean you have to take those courses. It's pretty much to your discretion where you take those courses.
I have a question.
Sure.
So when was this contract negotiated?
This contract was negotiated either last year.
The reason I'm asking, because I believe if it was negotiated in 2016, late in 2016, that they already had an increase for 2016, COLA increase.
They did have a COLA increase in 2016.
So that was the reason that the first year they only got 1 additional percent. So they actually got, let's say it was 2.5% in 16. They actually get 3.5% in 16.
Well, no, because this is actually 17. This first guy is 16-17, so it's the FY17 fiscal year.
So it doesn't go retroactive?
If it's retroactive, it would be retroactive to July 1, 2016.
That's right. That's what I'm saying.
But this is the contract for 2016-2017. The one before would have said July 1, 2015 to June 30th, 2016.
From that period just discussed until this July of 16 to June of 17, that's a 1% increase.
Yes.
1%. In the next 2 years are 2.5%.
1% on each step.
I understand.
Plus they would have gone from, they were on step 5, they would have moved to step 6.
Right.
And if during that time they increased, you know, they took additional courses that where they went from a bachelor's in 15 to a master's, they would have moved up the grade. There are some requirements that they, a teacher that expects to move, increase along a grade, increase in their grade from bachelor's to master's, that they notify the school, I don't know, by October 1st.
So they have a 17-step process.
No. Remember this, you don't see any 15, 16, 17, 18, and 19.
Right.
Step 20 is a longevity. And step 20, you have to work 20 years in for the Deerfield Elementary School or in one of the neighboring districts that are...
Union 38.
Union 38. The other thing that I would point out...
So I guess I don't understand why they voted themselves a 1% COLA. The first year.
You'd have to ask.
Why if they're negotiating 2.5 in year 2 and 3, why wouldn't they negotiate 2.5 in year 1? I believe that
probably wanted something else.
I think it's retroactive. I'm going to do some work.
Did they get any retroactive?
You would know because you'd see a jump in the someplace along the way when they paid that retroactive, you would have seen.
Barb would be probably more familiar with that than I would, but yes.
I mean, it's entirely possible that there's, you know, that they didn't actually sign the contract until September.
Well, that's, I'm sure, almost positive that's the fact. I know with Frontier, that's what happened.
And I'd also ask you to, you don't do it now, but just take a look at their leaves with pay, sick leave, and the sick leave bank.
Well, sick leave bank is something that all employees can contribute to, is that correct? It's not a given.
No, well, you read it, and then, while you're, again, I would not do, I don't want to take up the time here.
And what was the purpose of presenting this information?
So that you get some idea of what benefits other employees of the town get, that benefit, that the employees who work here do not get.
Well, maybe the town employees need to get a union.
That's possible.
See, that's...
You're not going to avoid it.
See, that's a difference, because the schools are union, they have professional representatives that do their negotiating, and they compare themselves to other school districts, they don't compare themselves to town districts, and that's the difference that you run into with union representation. And obviously, some of this, I mean, this has been years and years of the, in the makings, as far as the school contracts compared to town, you know, municipal contracts.
No doubt.
And there is a difference, right, wrong, and different.
It all comes out of the same checkbook.
It all comes out of the same budget, there's no question about it. And, you know, if you really wanted to push the envelope, then you'd have to compare hours too. So it's like, are you comparing apples and oranges or what? Because if you look at the hours and the work year and that, so I think it's very difficult to compare school contracts with municipal contracts at the moment.
Well, it is difficult.
It is.
But our employees here don't have a sick leave bank.
Mm-hmm.
They can't.
No, I understand.
All they can just sit one out.
No, they can't.
Why?
We don't allow it.
We don't allow it?
We don't allow it.
Was there a policy? I never read a policy saying we don't allow it.
Have you ever saw where it says they have one, can have one?
No, but until you request one, there's no policy. Somebody can go in.
If you have one, nobody ever...
If somebody was, use all the sick leave, and the employees in town wanted to give their sick leave to that employee, I'm sure the policy would be established, so that would happen.
I think you've talked about it, personnel, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. They're very difficult to manage and be fair to everybody, but I don't know what your conversations have been about.
Our conversation is one of those things that we really need to look at, because, like you said, the school has it, and I'm not sure, do the police have it?
I don't know. It's expensive.
It's expensive.
It's expensive.
Because that means that person is out of, you know, using somebody else's time to be out for an extended period of time.
It's easier when you have a larger workforce, I think.
I'm sorry?
It's a bit easier when you have a larger workforce.
Yeah.
I think gets even more complicated.
When you've got one person in an office, and then the sick leave goes on for 2 or 3 weeks, then we've got a problem.
2 or 3 weeks. This goes on, in some cases, goes on for a couple of years.
Yeah. The one from the school, I happen to know that two of them went on for over 2 years. So it's on the personnel board, we found that it was very expensive to do it and not a viable situation with as few employees as we have.
Well, it sounds like we need a good lawyer to represent the town in union negotiations. Sounds like we have residents in negotiations.
Which ones?
School contract negotiations.
Well, we can have a seat at the table. I don't know if the town has exercised that right.
What?
Yeah, they have the right.
You can either have a member of the select board or the town administrator at the negotiating table for the ed reform, and I don't know when the last time we have done that. So,
but they have set up for the elementary school negotiations is that all four towns can select one person from all four towns. Not four people, one person.
You're talking about
elementary or frontier? Tom Fike Kevitz, representing us.
Elementary.
Why would they be on our elementary school?
Because that's on the negotiating committee.
No, he's not. He said he's talking elementary.
For elementary, that's the way it used to be.
Well, so the negotiating.
One person for all four towns.
That's the way, I'm not sure where they came up with that.
Well, that's Union 38.
Because there really is no such thing as a Union 38 contract. You read through that, and you'll see that any reference to a contract references the town of Deerfield. It's a town of Deerfield contract.
To Deerfield Elementary.
Looks exactly like Conway, exactly like.
Sunderland has their own.
Exactly like Sunderland.
Conway has their own.
Just the name change.
Right.
But it is four separate contracts.
At the elementary.
At the elementary level.
They negotiated together, though?
Yeah, there's a joint negotiating.
But what they do have in their contracts, they've negotiated in good faith.
Well, that's not the argument. The argument that I'm trying to make here is that, you know, the employees, we have one set of employees broken up into various groups. And what I don't want to see, and unfortunately what I have seen over the past few years, is that the group of employees who work in these town off, in our town offices, have not had raises equivalent to the raises that have been given elsewhere in the town. And what happened, the police are a good example. They voted to unionize.
You have no argument here. As I've said, we treat some of these departments differently, but when you look at it, it all falls under the town, so why are we treating them differently?
Well, that's my point.
And I think we realize too that, I mean, as you go through here and you question budgets, God forbid if you should dare to question the school budget. Think about it. You know, the school budget basically is hands off. We can question every other budget, but you question the school budget, and guess what? You're not a very popular person. I'm not here to be a popular person.
Against us.
We typically, the schools have gotten what they've requested by and large. But that doesn't mean you can't ask them.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I think all budgets should, you should be able to, and it's our job to question budgets.
In any event, I would like to ask someone to vote to recommend this.
I'll recommend that we accept this classification schedule at this town meeting.
It's moved. It's seconded. Is there any further discussion?
Yes. Are we going to, is this for 1 year or is this for next 10 years?
Right.
The plan of the personnel board is to do it every year. Because what's happened is after 10 years, we've never given a cost of living in our classification schedule. So it's been outdated since the second year that it was in place.
So if we use the current and the proposed compensation schedule and we apply a COLA to it.
I don't believe we're planning to add a COLA.
Not this year.
Not this year, no.
But maybe next year.
Well, we'll put the COLA against the compensation schedule. Yes, basically, yes.
You'd be adding
but
the
that will be
step
because that's
plus the COLA.
Yep, could be.
Could be 8%. 7.5, 7, 8% increase.
Not for people at the top.
And what happens the year after that? Is it, say the COLA the year after that is 2.5%. Say it's 2.5% the first year.
Right.
And the next year COLA is, cost of living is 2.5%.
Right.
Does that mean they're going to get the amount on here plus 5% in year two?
Well, they got, we're going to.
Or are they going to get this plus 2.5%?
Right.
This plus the 2.5%.
Okay. If they gave a 2.5 COLA.
Then the new number will be that 7.5% increase from the next step.
Well, it'll be 2.5% for the next step.
Whatever the percentage is.
Yeah. The problem's been that over the 10 years, no one has gotten a cost of living increase. When the classification schedule was produced 10 years ago, this is what we've been hiring people at, and this is why the hiring process has gone all over the board on this thing. We need to get a working classification schedule, and this is a start.
I have no problem with the classification schedule. My problem is the automatic step, for one, and adding a COLA to the automatic step.
Would not
need to be one or the other.
Right.
If you're going to get a step increase,
well, they'll get the step increase, but the 2.5% will be applied towards the entire schedule. You're right in that respect.
Then they're starting with, that's what your question was, John.
Well, what do you do with this? This has a 3% increase.
You get a good lawyer next time we go.
Which one does?
This goes to a lawyer.
The teachers.
Who represents the town of Deerfield as a lawyer?
The school committee represents the town of Deerfield. That's what the law says.
We have no legal counsel.
You've got one, and I think you could make an argument that you could put one person from each town, but at this point, there's one person representing all four towns. Tom Feitenkavitz has been the person the last couple of years. So he was the one that negotiated this contract. So you could ask him, more than happy to have him come, and you can go talk with him.
The other issue, like you said, it's automatic, but the department head really has a choice of whether they put them up one more step or not. If they're not, that is their purview. If they want to put them, not move them up a step, they have that right. They don't have to move everybody up.
If everybody automatically goes up and you hold one person back?
If that person is not, it's very difficult. Yes, I agree.
It's the same thing here. At least during the first 3 years of a teacher's contract, the principal and superintendent together can decide not to reappoint a teacher.
Right.
There's no
probation.
Yeah. So the first 3 years you're on probation. After that, you got to do something pretty,
Okay. I was wrong.
Can I say something? I plan to work closely. I've started to work with the personnel board since I've been here, and we're going to talk about a lot of things, including moving to a policy from the bylaw, and talking about doing evaluations, relative to having step increases. That's what I've been hearing from a lot of you and from the board.
I think that's what the committee, at least there was two women here at the public hearing. I think they were on the committee.
Right.
And they were shocked. At least one of the women was shocked that they thought that these steps were going to be merit-based.
Well, because where she works, they are. Where a lot of people work, they are.
I work for the public sector, and I haven't got a raise in 10 years.
Is that fair?
Is that right?
If you're a nonprofit, it is fair. You either want your job, or if you don't have enough money to go out and give raises, you just can't give a raise. See, it's between your job and a raise.
And my argument is that if that were the case, then I would expect to see everyone else that gets paid out of the town's checkbook.
I understand.
To be on the same page. That's
the
argument.
You can't do that because there's a union. You can't do it with the police department.
We shouldn't have to have a union in order to pay our people what they should be getting. I don't believe. That's my argument.
I think the COLA is discretionary. I'm not committed to that, but it's discretionary up to recommendation from the personnel board and then select board. And of course, the finance committee wants to weigh in. So it's not an automatic. Obviously, it's not a unionized workforce we're talking about here. So the COLA, as I understand what has been happening over the last, I don't know how many years, people have been getting moved up a step unless you were at the top, and then you only got the COLA.
That's the only time the COLA was used.
Was it? Okay. Only time.
Right. When you're at the top step, you receive the COLA instead of a step increase.
Right.
So if we're at grade one and you're at step one this year, So next year, you go to step two at grade one, if you haven't improved your grade.
Grade or step?
So you'd go the step, right? If you didn't improve on grade level for any reason.
Grade level only changes when you change positions.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So you go from step one to step two, which would be the 13.72.
Right.
Now, are you saying that the that would be the 13.72 per hour plus a COLA on top of that?
That's not, that would have to, that would be up to
decided here, but
the selectmen, personnel committee, and town meeting.
And it's not on this one.
So could I make a comment?
Add the COLA.
Yes.
Sure.
Other than this last few years, there's no compensation plan that has ever run its course, because they've had to be adjusted continually because of the same problem. Mm-hmm. So can this, I don't want to put a time frame on it, but maybe change the motion, and I don't know whether it's at this point in time or on the floor, to just be subject to annual review.
Which they are
and
anyway.
That would lead, well, I understand that, but put it in writing, and yeah. That way there's no ands, ifs, or buts about it, that this is subject to annual review, and then that way there's no question, because I don't think any of us are really upset about the initial.
I think the bylaw requires it.
It is, it's
and
town
we
bylaw.
Would adopt it as the FY19. Yes, FY19.
Oh, it would be adopted as a one-year compensation plan?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. FY8.
So, and I agree with you, Bruce. And reason, one reason is that if we, I lost my thought, I'm sorry. I'll come back to it.
But that is what the bylaw says. We will review it every year. But we need to get something started. We need we want our employees to know that we're at least we're trying to.
And I'm not arguing that. No, I'm not arguing that point. Yeah. But I'm just saying if it's made public that it is annual, because I wasn't aware of that myself, and I,
well,
you know, coming
we
from
haven't done it. For
yeah.
Years.
Well, yeah, but most of the people on the floor are
<We're> not.
So,
no.
Come on.
but you know, part of the thing is most people don't understand a lot of this stuff. And if you just put those few words in here that it's subject to an annual review, it would probably prevent a lot of discussion that such as we're having right here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and that was brought up earlier in an earlier meeting with the personnel board as far as annual review.
Yeah, so.
The reason I have, the reason I remember is that I wanted to speak to, is when we go through budgets, if this is going to be an annual step increase, we have no say as a finance committee. We might as well just not even include budgets on what we recommend. Because we have no say at all, just like the schools and just like the police department. This is fixed, and if it's going to be only in, we're not. I mean, why are we voting and recommending a salary? We don't have the ability to change it.
We don't have the ability, anyways. We're just a recommending.
If we recommend lower, where are we going to take it from? We can't take it from salaries.
You could.
How would we do that?
You could recommend that.
Well, we just grab any budget.
Well, you wouldn't be able to do that with the school or the police, because those are negotiated. Right?
And
those
are set in stone. We have nothing we can say about those either.
We would, if somebody was going from step seven to eight, we could say no.
No, what we could recommend is this. Here's a budget. It's 149 and salaries, 149,000.
So we could recommend that the town doesn't have, we could say, look, the town doesn't have the money, we would recommend a budget of $130,000.
Same as last year.
Or same as last year. And then that would then be up to the town to figure out how to, if
to
they,
make it work.
Well.
Yeah, that's going to be a nightmare.
Well,
yeah,
it would be.
It would be.
So we don't, I mean, if we're going to use an automatic step without any merit, we should not be recommending salaries. We for the Finance Committee.
And, you know, I can understand your point. What I don't understand is why you're going to tell people that work in this building that they need to be paid differently from the people that work in every other building in town. And I've got a problem with that. I've had a problem from day one.
I think that they need to get together and create a union.
That's their privilege.
Most of these people, like myself and perhaps Brenda, I don't know, we have to...
Salary?
You are, yes, salary, and I have a contract.
I understand.
But most of the others do not, and mostly department heads and their salary even would...
There aren't that many employees.
Yeah, so they would not be able to collectively...
The two largest departments in the town, as opposed to the schools, are the police and the highway department. And, you know, there are 8 or 9 employees in the police department, and if you include wastewater treatment, you've got 10 or 11 employees in the highway department. And then you've got 7 or 8 employees in here. That's it.
That's it.
Okay, well, let's go on motion.
All right, if there's any further discussion?
As long as we're understanding that this is going to be an annual review.
That's what the town bylaw says.
What the bylaw says, and that's what we've intended to do.
An annual review of the employee or an annual review of the plan?
The plan.
The classification.
Both, actually. It would be nice if it was both.
We can't have both. We can't review the...
But I mean, they're, the department head should be reviewing the...
Some type of review.
They tried that, and that didn't work.
There are reviews that take place.
Yeah, they're still, I mean, even with that horrendous plan that they gave us to review our employees, most of us kind of went around it and created our own review system.
Well, that...
If an employee doesn't work for you, you need to let the employee know that what they're doing is not acceptable and follow the steps.
Well, and I understand.
Most of these departments are working above and beyond. The state is adding more and more to them.
You don't have to tell me, Mary. I understand that. You know, the reason I say it didn't work is because the problem is it's too small a group, and peer pressure lends itself. And the department head is the one that we're doing and reviewing rather than an independent coming in with a questionnaire and a point system and saying, okay, this is where it works out. But and that's why I feel it could never really work when it was introduced is... it's like when I was the assessor, okay, you got three part-time, very part-time assessors reviewing the one person in there that's full-time.
Yeah.
Okay, well, you know, we come in, the job was done. I mean, you know, was that truly a merit-based thing? No, because you really don't know how, you know, just from hearsay, I mean, you know, she reacted well, very well with the public and within the town hall and everything, but it's really not conducive to what my opinion would be and your opinion would be and John's opinion would be, you know, and that's why, you know, until you get into a bigger source where you have an actual HR person that can do an independent review, it's very hard to, you know, change this over to merit system. That's my opinion, though.
I would agree. It's impossible to change it over to
merit.
The salary merit. That doesn't mean that employees shouldn't receive a performance review. And
right.
If they're not working up to the expectation and they've been warned and you've written it down, then you may have to turn around and say, we appreciate the fact that you've worked here for the last 4 years, but for all of that time, you just haven't worked up to
right.
the expectations, and you know you're being dismissed.
Yeah.
I mean, I
would agree with that.
I chuckle at that.
Instead of merit, as long as there is a performance sometime. Review.
Yeah, I worked, as I think all of you know, I taught school for 10 years, and the basic review process there was the principal would come into your classroom. You had advance notice, typically, but in addition to the fact that you interacted with that person all the time. So the principal would come into your classroom and then sit down and go through, I'm going to call it a checklist, it's more than a checklist. But I taught math, high school math,
And the principal, two principals that I had, that I worked for, one was a, had been an art teacher, the other one was a history teacher. And I can assure you that at least my senior level students in math were better at math than the person who was reviewing me. So, you know, should have asked the students what kind of teacher I was, I guess.
Motion to move the question.
Yeah.
So, we've got a question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
One. Me.
Any abstentions?
Abstain for now.
So we've got one abstention, one opposed, that means five voted for. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
Can I add something to that afterwards, now that we're done?
Sure.
If you look at step one, you go from grade one to step two, the increase is 72 cents.
Mm-hmm.
In the old schedule, it's 80 cents.
Understood.
So it's 80 cents for every step.
I understand. Okay. That,
but I'm just saying.
72 cents on $13 is over 5%. Right.
This was 80 cents on $10.
I'm not saying the old one was right.
No.
I'm just okay. saying 5% is too high.
Well.
Yes. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
Well.
But we are going to recommend it, right?
We did.
Yep.
I guess. Can we?
So that was 5-1-1.
But can I ask a question,
sure.
even though we voted it? Next year, when we're looking at a budget for a wage line item?
We should see this first.
It's going to be based on this. Based on the number of people they propose they have in that department?
Yes.
Based on this. Can we sit there and vote? We are, as a finance committee, can we say we don't recommend that amount?
Per individual?
No, or in total
for the
department?
For the total?
Yeah, because it's based on this. Can we still vote against it?
I guess you can.
Yeah.
Yep.
I mean, you know, when it comes up to a vote, you know, do you vote the town clerk treasurer's salary is $149,000? You can say no.
Even though it's based on this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Why not?
All right.
If we have to cut somewhere, yeah. I mean, it's going to be the town budget that gets...
No, I'm not saying we're going to cut. I'm not saying
no,
that.
I know,
I'm just
I
wondering
that,
what
I'm
might
saying,
happen.
If,
yeah, any
if
budget has
to
a salary, you just...
The town budget.
Say no.
You can't cut anything out.
Knock that out.
And the other thing that I think, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but if we're going to get these budgets by sometime in late December, that means that the salary schedule, at least a recommended salary schedule, has to be forthcoming before January 1st. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So whatever changes.
Now that we have an administrator, we can get that done.
Hope so.
We're going to hold you to it.
Article 8, see if the town will amend Chapter 35 personnel bylaws by adding a longevity pay.
It's on the back, passing this out. This is what was handed out at the hearing the personnel board had for the bylaw, and it's on the back of the front page.
Sorry.
I had extra copies. This was what went out to town employees. First page, back of first page. That's the last page. There you go. Narrative format. So this is what the personnel board recommended, and it'll be shaped into a bylaw language for the motions.
I'm sorry?
I just turned it over to you. I said, this is what the personnel board recommended, and I'll shape it into bylaw language for the warrant, for the motion at the end.
Motion.
If.
Yeah.
I guess I'm confused. 2A, it says upon completion of 10 years of continuous town service, you get $200.
Yes.
And up to year 14, then that would, so in those 4 years or 5 years, you get
$200.
Okay.
Yeah. Same goes for all of them.
Yep.
Bruce?
And the motion will say.
You raised to me whether this should be in a policy versus.
Yeah.
We don't have a policy at this point, so we're working with the bylaws until we can move to the policy format for the personnel.
Yeah, this is a bylaw.
It's.
The compensation plan.
Yes, it's adding to our bylaw until we can change the bylaw entirely, move to a policy form.
So we're going to make this a policy, not?
No, not now.
We don't, yeah, we're not going to policy, we're going to do it in one fell swoop.
Oh, okay.
Or, you know, build on it, get.
Okay.
Okay.
So.
We tried to do this a few years ago.
You did, as part of this, there's this addendum one, which is, what's that, like the average general government wage schedule?
That's, I gave all my copies, I'm sorry, is that the current schedule?
General government wage schedule current, yes.
Yeah, that's what.
Interesting to note that where our proposed wage schedule is higher.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
This is an old one, I think.
Yeah, this is the original.
Oh, is it old?
I was trying to contrast what we.
Yeah, it goes back to 2010, I believe.
Okay, moot point then.
I believe, so.
All right, it's old, all right.
So I guess my question is.
So it's not current.
And I don't want to be picky on, but defined continuous, I mean, somebody goes into service for a couple of years, does that mean they broke service and?
There's a rule for service.
For veterans, yeah.
I'm just using that as an example, but.
Right, there is a rule for them so that if they go into service, all of their benefits continue.
But a non-veteran, no.
Pardon?
A
non-veteran, no.
Right.
It wouldn't be continuous service.
So somebody left here and went to work for Sunderland.
Yeah.
And then 5 years later came back.
They couldn't come back.
They come back and then brand new.
Start over.
So they start over.
That's not continuous service.
That's not continuous.
Well, you know, I defer to the personnel board because this is their proposal, so Mary wants to speak to these.
So I guess, what would continuous be? Would that mean no more than a break of 2 weeks, no more than a break of 6 months?
Continuous.
Somebody gets hurt, if they gets hurt, they're on the payroll, but they're not.
Yeah, but a break of 2 weeks could be a vacation week.
Right, that's what I'm saying. It's, I think that needs a little bit.
That's still a paid service.
So many days of the year you have to work?
Well, something. I just think that it's kind of an open hole.
There were a couple of things that were brought to my attention that we could, you know, clarify more. I forget what the other one was, but that was one of them, so.
One of the things that most places typically, one of the pieces of information that most employers have is a start date.
A start date?
A start date. When did you start working here?
And when did you stop working?
Well, if you left and came back, you get a new start date.
Right.
Yeah.
Presumably.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess I could understand.
Continuous from the start date?
Well, I don't know.
Are you going to be able to add?
Yeah, but if you're out on workers' comp, you can't ding the employee for that because they dropped a vice on their foot or something.
Well, but they didn't, their start date wouldn't change.
Right.
So if you left and took a job someplace else and then came back a couple of years later, you're going to have a new start date.
Yes.
Presumably what you would use. I don't know. I'm just.
That's another hole.
I'm just commenting here as to what I would expect.
Yes.
Well, it says uninterrupted continuous employment. I think employment's a very key word here.
Yep.
Any further questions?
Are we voting on 8?
Yeah.
As a bylaw, Article 8.
I make a motion.
We have a motion to accept the proposed longevity plan.
I'll second it.
Moved, seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? So it's a 7-0. Omnibus budget. I think there are several. And even if these are not on the this budget, let's go through them a little bit.
So
of the new ones?
Yes. Yeah.
That's one of the articles.
I think this goes from page nine to Article 23, nine to 23. Boy, this one I have, I didn't get double-sided. Mine wasn't double-sided when you made the additional copy.
They just made the copy of it.
They gave me the original, you want me to sign it?
Well, missing...
Missing the article.
He's missing 10 through 22.
Articles 10 through 22.
It's just the signature?
No, the article.
No, the second page.
Yeah, the machine, okay.
Yeah.
The machine.
Machine.
What do you, so, I'm sorry, which articles do you need that?
We need the backside.
10 through 20.
Through 22.
10 through 22.
You just go to the page, I'm going to make it all, I'm going to just do the whole thing.
Yeah.
We can still do nine while she's...
Go to another.
We can still do nine while she's doing that.
29 is last.
Yeah, yeah.
No, it's not.
If you would, in discussing this reserve fund, if you take a look at page three of the... And we, I think we had talked and we had voted to include $5,000 for, it says Article 18, Smith... Smith School.
Yeah, for Smith vote, yes.
And there was a total of $10,000 there. After talking with Brenda and Wendy today, the thought was, maybe it would make sense to take that, those two $5,000 numbers out, increase the reserve fund so the money was available, and get rid of those two. And if we have a student that comes in, it's going to cost a lot more than $10,000, and I don't want to give the wrong impression to members of the town meeting.
That's all it's cost.
Yeah.
Right, that means that's not a false, right.
So the money would be available, but we've just eliminated that Article 18.
Right.
So if you take a look at Article 18, we're getting, is there a new Article 18, or are we just bypassing it?
We'll just have to bypass it, is what we would do at the town meeting.
So the reserve fund, $90,000, means that Article 18 disappears. Is that acceptable to everybody?
Generally?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Something to vote on, is that what you want to do?
Yeah, I want to vote on that, but I just wanted you to know that we're just going to cross out Article 18.
Right.
So increasing the reserve fund from $80,000 to $90,000, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Is that unanimous?
Who made the motion?
Oh, sorry, who made the motion?
I did.
Who seconded it? I did. So it was moved and seconded.
And then do you need to vote to eliminate Article 18?
Yeah.
Yes.
No, just pass over.
Just go pass over.
Yeah. Not recommended.
Not recommend the two $5,000 figures.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll get to Article 18.
Okay.
Do we have any other omnibus budget articles that we needed to...
Not that I'm aware of. We voted all the omnibus budget articles previously.
Okay.
Yes.
And there has been, and you can ask Brenda, but we took a couple of the articles, warrant articles that we normally vote separately, and moved them into the omnibus budget.
That's correct. Like the FERCog core assessment, which is under the 800 and 900 series, and the unfunded sick leave and vacation, we decided that that really belonged in the omnibus budget. Why we voted them separately in the past, I think maybe was because we were trying to skim the budget and use free cash for them, I'm not sure. But, and then the quinquennial recertification.
Was it also that you couldn't add to it if you put it in an omnibus budget?
I don't know why they didn't include it in the past. I'm just surmising why it was never.
I'm just wondering if they can add, say, $10,000 this year and $10,000 next year, and add them together and have $20,000 in that account. As an article, you could do that, right?
I suppose that's possible, yes. Yeah, if it was an article, you could carry it over. It could be a continuing appropriation.
So, for example, the, what used to be called triennial.
Recertification.
Recertification. Did that one get moved by any chance?
It did. It's now in the omnibus budget.
So we may want to take a look at that to see if that's where it belongs. We put $20,000 in there, and every year, it's going to go back into the.
Well, right now, it has about $29,000 left. I understand there's still a bill for this fiscal year, but they're thinking what's left in there can be continued, you know, so that they can use it next year. So that's why they're not asking for anything this year.
But what I'm saying is.
So they're not asking for anything this year.
Correct.
What I'm saying is if they, next year.
It would just be part of the omnibus budget, you know, just like any other line item.
But that, if they didn't use.
They can't carry it forward.
They can't carry it forward.
They can't carry it forward.
And they carry that, they always carry it forward.
Well, they had because, partly because of something happened, and we were not only continuing the appropriation, but we were budgeting this yearly amount every year, so it continued with that amount. So we're just trying to rectify the problem, and we will in fiscal 18 have it completely rectified so that we're not doing that again.
So my question is, if the idea is to put $20,000 aside.
Well, they're paying for it now yearly, so there's no reason to set money aside like there was in the past, because they're paying for it annually.
Oh, okay.
It's always been paid for annually.
Has it? Okay.
Yes.
But the $10,000 for the.
Yeah, but I thought it was like a three-year contract.
Right.
It's a three-year contract. You could have the money somewhere in order to sign that contract.
Okay, right.
So that, and that's why they were doing it as a separate article every year.
I suppose if that happened and we needed to pull it out for fiscal 19, we could pull it out for fiscal 19.
Okay. So this is, as I understand it, the breakdown that the town meeting will have in some form. So that when we're talking about the budget, they're going to be in here.
I would think that we'll put the budget summary in the booklet, and then we'll also put the Finance Committee recommendations list mm-hmm. in there as well.
Yeah, because that's what we, the moderator goes through that and reads those one at a time, and members of the town meeting can question each of these individually. Okay. Any other questions on the omnibus budget? We need to vote the
you got to do a couple of these changes here too. The two $5,000 things you have here.
Yeah.
That will automatically change when I update this spreadsheet. These spreadsheets will update,
okay.
And I'll check to make sure.
We'll get there when we do Article 18.
All right.
Okay. So we did the reserve fund, right?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay. Next article, 10. That's the OPEB. Did we voted that one?
Correct.
Okay.
We voted for 10,000.
Okay.
So we're doing nothing with mine right at this point. Right. Mm-hmm.
And did we vote the wastewater treatment plant?
Yes, we did.
We did vote their budget in March.
That's Article 11. Article 12 mm-hmm. is SCEMS.
Yes.
Wait a minute. Don't we have a problem with 11?
I don't know.
What's that?
To raise and appropriate? For wastewater treatment
the
plants.
That's the
wording that
that's
they've always used
language.
For that article.
The language you can take from any place. And the motion identifies the source that you're going to use.
Okay.
Correct.
I think we voted SCEMS also, did we not?
Mm-hmm.
We do need to
it gets vote the...
It's stapled in the wrong place just for you, Skip.
What's that?
The sheet's stapled in the wrong place just for you.
It was just me. It was just one.
And John, you were the first one.
I was the only one.
Should we discuss that today? In regards to the wastewater treatment plant language.
Everybody else go there.
Who would like a fresh new, more stable copy?
I think they should be framed.
Of what?
Hate the waste paper.
What's this? Is this different than what we...
No.
No.
Someone stop me. Okay.
The same thing, right?
Yeah.
We voted Skip, right?
I believe we voted Skip.
Yes, we did.
Yes, we did.
We're on, we were just talking about Article 12.
Article 12. We're all set with that. Article 13.
Yep.
I got a problem with that.
Problem with which?
Article 13, based on the, I mean, this isn't the motion, I understand.
No, correct.
But do we want to get into the detail now, or what?
Yes.
The warrant articles on the summary of, from Brenda, shows Article 13, $228,500.
Yes.
CIPC recommended $102,813. I got to add back.
Which one? Of the overall?
Yeah, I have to add back. We subtracted the Sundal and...
I was going to ask what that is.
So that is, you'll see the list on page 4 of your annual town meeting finance committee budget recommendations.
We have it here?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Page 4. So we have the new voting machine at $6,500.
Yeah.
The salt shed repair at $7,000. Elementary school entry foyer drainage, $6,500. Replace door hardware at the school, $12,500. And again at the school, replace flooring for $17,000. So out of general taxation and free cash, we're taking $49,500. Then if you look down below, then we have from the South County EMS Enterprise Fund retained earnings, $108,000 for the ambulance reserve, 3 IV pumps at $21,000, and 2 stretcher load systems at $50,000. So that's $179,000. You add those two figures together and it's $228,500. I know I did not present it that way before, but looking through it today, I realized that I needed to account for the enterprise fund retained earnings amount, both in the revenue and in the expense, which is why that number is the 228.5.
Mike, the question that I had was, shouldn't we have two separate articles?
No, the capital for both is included in one article.
I know it is, but shouldn't they be?
That was a discussion I had with Joe Markarian, and he and I both agreed that it needed to be separate. So the operating a budget is voted in Article 12, and then the capital budget is voted with the rest of our capital in 13.
Yeah. But that should, I would prefer seeing these two pieces listed separately. So we would have a capital budget request for the town of $49,500. And then a capital budget request for SCIMS of $179,000.
I was told to include them together in one article, so that's what I did.
No, I'm.
Aren't they going to be outlined anyway, right?
What's that?
Yes. When the motion's made, they're going to be outlined anyway.
Exactly. They'll be in two separate, we can put them in two separate little groups so that it would be as it is here.
Because I would like to vote those separately.
Mm-hmm. I understand that. I would, too.
Actually, is the motion going to show what CIPC recommended?
I didn't know how that should
that's
be.
That's how it was done last year.
Okay.
They had a column, warrant, column, CIPC.
Okay.
Well, Doug, if you look at the annual report last year, it was right in the warrant. They had the item and then.
Okay.
I have a question. I listened to Joe at SCIMS when he gave his talk, and he talked about a stabilization fund for ambulance money that would be set aside for ambulances. This is not a capital expense. $108,000. It's money that will end up in the stabilization fund.
No, it's money that's going to end up in a capital project fund. And that capital project fund will just continue to collect money until at which time they decide that they're going to buy their ambulance.
And they can do it in there, inside the enterprise fund?
It's not in the enterprise fund, it's in a capital projects fund.
So it's in the town?
It will be a transfer out of the enterprise fund into a capital fund.
Okay.
Yeah.
So make sure.
But it still stays in the...
It's its own separate capital project fund within the town of Deerfield.
Right. And it takes 2/3 to take it out?
No.
He said stabilization fund.
It's not a stabilization fund, it's a capital project fund.
That's what he said.
And, but it does require a town meeting vote to spend out of that?
It does not.
What does it take?
Nothing.
Just for them to give me the bills and I pay out of it with their approval.
Yeah, I have a problem with that too.
I understood Joe McCarron saying that it was, need to be a stabilization fund.
No.
But it's been approved by...
I know.
Committees of the town for them to spend the money.
Yeah, but they're not going to spend it for 5 years.
Well, if you have no say over it, they could spend it in 4 years. Move up in the way.
Okay.
Yeah, let them spend it when they want it.
I mean, I can see that some of this money will be spent in the next year. But I don't understand lumping capital items that will not be spent into a capital warrant.
Apparently, that's the way enterprise funds will do that, or with any capital project that you have, you continue to build up for it, and then you spend out of it.
We did it with the school roof.
So you've approved...
No, I know, and Sluckman would approve that use of that money, is that right? We didn't have to bring it to town meeting to spend that money?
Pardon?
We didn't have to bring a vote to the town meeting to use that reserve?
No, just... of course, it took sign-offs by the OPM and the architect and the town of Deerfield. You know, everybody had to sign off on those things before I could pay the bill.
No, but the money we initially used, $100,000+, it was in a capital stabilization or whatever.
Oh, it was in a revolving fund.
Revolving fund.
I think it was.
What are we talking about?
The roof.
Oh, the first $200,000 that we spent for the school roof was an article. We had articles to set that money aside over the last, I don't know, 5 years, whatever it is that we set money aside. So it was just a continuing appropriation. So when the school submitted those bills, the school committee approved those bills, and then I paid out.
So that's what this is similar to then?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure of the process.
Yes.
Thank you. I don't like it.
I don't like it either. And, you know, if we're going to end up casting one vote, I'm going to cast a vote of no for the
Are you talking about Article 13?
I'm talking about Article...
It wasn't presented to us that way.
Article 13.
So we can do two motions, right?
Sure.
What's wrong with it? I don't understand why you have a problem with it.
Because typically capital items, you approve of capital expenditures, and they'll be spent in the next fiscal year. They're not going to be held for 3 or 5 years in a capital reserve account, is that it?
It's a capital project fund.
Fund, right. So we're just approving, you're approving an annual appropriation to a fund, the CIPC.
It's just a transfer of money from one bucket to another bucket within skims.
Out of skims into...
And then...
Out of the enterprise fund into a separate account.
And that
but
money...
But it's still a skims fund.
My argument, my concern is that we've got money at this point sitting in retained earnings. If it's in retained earnings, in order to take it out of retained earnings, requires a town committee, a town meeting vote. So we take it out of retained earnings, we stick it into, and I'm going to call it a slush fund, and then the SCEMS Board of Oversight can spend it at will.
Only for an ambulance.
Right. So
The capital project is an ambulance. If they don't spend it on an ambulance, then it gets put back into retained earnings.
But the capital project, does it say that it's an ambulance?
It will.
Okay. That covers that.
The reserve fund, the, yeah.
Yeah, that goes into, it's going to say.
Yeah, if it's set in a reserve fund, I guess I could, but if it's not.
It's a capital project fund designated for the ambulance.
Right. Which.
They're going to call it that, Skip.
I know they're going to call it that, but we will never.
And she won't approve it.
We will never again.
Well, and Wendy has to sign off on all the things that get spent out of those funds, too. So you've got her overseeing that as well.
Yes, but no one else. It's not that it ever goes back to the town meeting, and that's what I would like to see, the town meeting make the decision to buy the ambulance. Because that's what we did when we set money aside for the ambulance. We set it aside, and then at some point in time, we went to town meeting. We voted to take $250,000.
I see.
$100,000 from free cash, $150,000 from the ambulance reserve fund, and that's the way the motion was put together. And that's the way I'd like to see it put together.
I see your point. Nobody's approving the purchase of the ambulance.
Nope.
That way, right.
All we're doing is approving.
That's a good point.
Well, it specifically says ambulance reserve.
Yeah, but nobody's approving the purchase of an ambulance.
Not at this point.
In this process.
I wasn't sure when I listened.
No, that's a good.
When I listened to.
That's the problem.
Joe speak.
Well, that's what you're saying.
Yep.
That you don't trust the SCAMS board.
Well, also, anything else that we ever did from the town side was always taken back to the town meeting for approval. Now, I understand that there are plenty of other towns who do things a lot differently than we do, and they don't go through every item on the omnibus budget list. They, you know, get five categories, and they just vote each one of them. It's like, that's it. Takes 10 minutes.
I would assume when SCAMS does their budget for the year that they decide to buy that ambulance, that they're going to let you know that that's what they're going to do. They're going to spend out of that capital projects fund. I can't imagine they wouldn't let you know that. That's part of the process.
You have a choice.
Theoretically, yeah. Yeah.
All right. So I just wasn't sure. When I listened to him, I wasn't sure that it stayed in the enterprise fund or was separate.
Yeah, it's being taken out of the enterprise fund and put in a capital projects fund.
Which the town has control over.
Yes, correct.
But the town has control over the whole thing anyways, so it's.
No, three towns have control.
No.
Not in this case. It'll go into a capital projects fund at Deerfield.
Right.
But the only one that has to approve the purchase of the ambulance is Wendy.
Is the oversight board.
And the oversight board, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, in theory.
Both.
Yeah, so I agree with you guys now. Maybe it should be a stabilization fund.
Wow.
And then.
I don't think they can set up a stabilization fund within an enterprise fund.
Can they can designate.
I think that's the whole issue.
That is.
They can designate a portion of retained earnings for capital projects.
But you can't have a separate.
It's not staying in retained earnings.
They can't.
It's coming from retained earnings.
It's coming from retained earnings.
And it's going to a separate fund.
Yes.
Yeah.
I would like, if there was some way of setting it up as a separately controlled piece of retained earnings, then I would have no problem with it. What's that?
Right.
How did this happen? I listened to Joe on TV last night, and he explained all this relative to what was, and nobody has brought this to the committee.
It came to the committee when you voted for it. It was pretty specific.
Well, we knew exactly that $108,000 was from retained earnings FY16, XY17, retained earnings, and I had questions then. But I didn't realize it came out of enterprise fund. I thought it stayed within the enterprise fund in a capital reserve account. It was then had to be voted on as an expenditure like retained earnings?
It was Joe Markarian's suggestion, because I did ask him that question, to put it into a capital projects fund.
So the suggestion is required by the enterprise fund?
Well, they can't have stabilization, so we have to...
Well, I don't know, I'm not sure if they can or cannot.
You can't have a stabilization fund within an enterprise fund.
You can have a capital reserve fund, though, like you have, like reserve, like your operating reserves.
Where's the operating reserve going?
That's just part of the operating budget.
You don't want this to be an operating budget.
As long as it's... Not much we can say about it.
I can certainly check with DOR to make sure that he agrees with what Joe is suggesting.
We had a speaker 2.5 years ago come to speak, and he said, you have capital reserve fund within the enterprise fund. And that's what they had done, but they actually hadn't set the line item up. And now we're saying we couldn't have done it anyway.
I don't know.
Okay, so can we vote these?
Yep.
There's two pieces. The $49,500.
Okay, you want me,
Can we do that?
Can I make the motion even though I'm on the CIPC?
Why not?
Should make the motion.
Okay, I make a motion, we approve the $49,500 in warrant Article 13, that we approve that.
Second.
So it's moved to second, and on town meeting floor, all of those items will be listed so that you know, if anybody, you know, wants to know, says, I don't like that, I want to vote against one of these items, but I want to vote for the other four.
They usually list them out.
It's going to be listed separately.
Well, you're going to have a sheet that tells us what it is, too, right?
This is it?
Yeah.
It needs to show what CIPC.
Yeah,
we can do that.
Charted as well.
And is there any reason that we could not set that up similar to the way we'll set up the omnibus budget article? We'll get down through each item and put a hold on it, and or not?
On your page 4, you have the opportunity to do exactly that.
Okay.
Which is all part of the same spreadsheet.
If we can do that, that would be appreciated.
It's here.
Motion made and seconded.
So there's a motion made and seconded capital improvement article for $49,500. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? So that's 7-0-0. And then an article for what's the name of this fund that we're setting this up?
Skim's Enterprise Fund Retained Earnings.
That's where it's coming from. Where is it going to?
Capital project.
No, 180 is going to a capital project.
We'll go into a capital.
21 and 50 will be spent.
Correct.
Okay, so 108 goes into the
ambulance reserve.
Well, it's not an ambulance reserve fund, though.
Why isn't it?
Ambulance capital projects fund.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's vote that one separately, then, since that's going into the, and the other ones are, I don't know, where's the other money going into?
Going into a line item for that specific item, that specific capital item.
Okay. So, can I have a motion for the ambulance capital which fund?
Project fund.
Project fund?
So moved.
I'll second.
What's the motion?
It's 108 to
transfer $108,000 from retained earnings to the capital project fund.
Ambulance reserve.
Capital project.
Capital project.
Ambulance capital project fund.
That's what they call, I'm just saying that because that's what it is on here.
I'll change the description of it.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Wait a minute. Okay, who made the motion?
I did.
Who seconded?
I did.
I'm sorry. Okay, got it. Vote again.
So a show of hands. All those in favor of transferring $108,000 to the ambulance capital project fund? Show of hands.
Yep.
So four. All those opposed? Three.
Four.
Four.
Three and four.
It's three, four.
But there's only seven on the committee.
Three, four.
Three, four, zero.
That means it failed.
Well, I'm sorry. I thought you voted yes. Okay, sorry. So it's three in favor, four opposed, so it's not recommended at least. The IV pumps, can we lump the IV pumps in the stretcher load system? Or do you want to vote those separately?
CIPC voted for 25 on the stretcher load systems. They only approved the purchase of one.
Okay. Let's vote them separately.
But that doesn't mean.
Yep. Let's just go ahead and vote them separately. Can I have a motion on the three IV pumps?
So moved.
Got a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
It's moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So is that 7-0?
Yes.
On the stretcher load system, can I have a motion there?
So moved.
What are you moving?
$50,000 for the two stretcher load systems.
Second.
So we've got $50,000 that we're voting on. It's moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? One?
6-1-0.
6-1-0. Okay. Have fun writing that up.
Thanks.
You'll do a great job.
Okay, so that was Article 14. Article 15, we voted this one, didn't we?
Yes.
That was 13 we just voted, right?
No, that was it?
Yeah.
Yes, it was 13. Okay, see if the town will vote to establish, we voted that one.
We did not vote anything on 14 yet.
Oh, we didn't? I thought we voted to set up the capital expenditure stabilization.
Yeah, we voted for $200,000.
We voted to put the money in. This is establishing it.
But you also voted the capital as well, and you revoted.
Okay, so Article 14, this is to set up the fund, right?
Right. I make a motion, we approve it.
Seconded.
Seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 7-0. Number 15 is the actual money which we voted.
$200,000.
Yes. See if the town will vote to raise and appropriate from free cash or other available funds money, snow and ice removal. The number for that is?
$117,102.
So that's what we've overspent, that.
That was overspent by that amount?
Yes.
Correct.
Overspent the 83.
Over the 85,000?
85,000.
That's correct.
I asked that same question.
You were in Florida.
It was nice down there.
I was in Phoenix, so.
So you guys ought to pay it all because we had to stay up here and put up with the snow.
I got my bill for snow plowing, so.
Okay. We don't have a choice in this one other than we can leave it alone and let it run through the.
You can leave it alone, let it, then put it right on the recap sheet.
That's where we'll go. So the question is, do we want to pay for it or do we want it to go through the recap? And the recommendation is to pay for it.
I think we should pay for it this year.
But this is a fund we can't lower next year.
We can, no, because we have 85,000.
That's fair.
That's the number that we can't lower.
Correct.
Okay. Any discussion on this other than to say we don't like it? Okay.
I don't know if any of you read the paper, but I think a lot of towns have had the same experience this year, and I think it's because they had to do the same amount of work for all these little snowstorms as they would have to do if they had a bunch of big snowstorms.
Yeah, same amount of work.
Yeah.
I think it's different in the way we do it. We pre-salt for a storm, which most...
I think Bernardston does too. I don't know how the rest of the towns are, but...
Sand, salt, yes.
Saves them a lot of money in sand.
Do you want a motion on this?
Yes.
Make a motion, we support Article 16.
Second.
It's moved, seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so 7-0?
Yep.
Article 17, see if town recommend the community preservation. We haven't seen these yet.
So if you look on that same page that you have your capital projects on, I did add it down below. There's a request for complete fencing on the north side of Sugarloaf Cemetery for $6,500. And then there's a request to repair and stabilize the obelisk of the Civil War Monument for $31,000. And I just used the exact language that was in the email.
Any questions?
Yes. The cemetery fencing is going to replace in place what's there, or there's no fence there?
I have no idea.
That is to complement what was there previous 2 years ago. It was allotted $16,500, I believe.
Yeah.
Was supposed to do two sides when the bids came in. It was almost $16,000 for one side, and rather than come back for more money, they just went ahead and did that.
Yeah.
And so they supposedly, this is an estimate to do the other side.
So they know where to put it. They know the...
Oh, they had already done the surveying, okay. I believe, on the first one, because... So the surveying supposedly is completed.
Oh, and on the right side or the left side?
Well, it'd be on the right-hand side along the building where they've got the cement-filled post.
Behind Fisher's Garage and...
Yeah, along Sharsky's.
The computer place.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right?
Yep.
2018?
Yep.
Okay, just let's go ahead and vote the fence first, $6,500.
I'll move.
Seconded?
Second.
Moved, seconded. All those in favor, $6,500?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 7-0. Next one, repair and stabilize the obelisk of the Civil War Monument, $31,000.
I'll move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none?
The obelisk is going to stay there.
Right there?
No.
No.
No, that's the monument in Deerfield.
Just the concrete.
This is just the concrete.
Base.
Just the base.
The base.
Yeah, the 29-foot-high base.
Maybe they can put that thing back on top of it so it doesn't keep scaring me every time I walk in.
I figured I'd ask you because you're the chairman. Does that bring their fund under $2 million yet?
What?
I have no idea.
CPA? CPC?
Yeah.
No.
It sell over $2 million. Okay.
Yeah, I think so.
All right. All those in favor of $31,000?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous? Is that right?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. Where are we? 18. So...
That's out.
There's no recommendation. Or we... Yeah. We're not recommending 18. Based on the vote.
It's going to be bypassed, so I mean, no.
Pass over.
Well, okay.
Right?
Move Article 19?
19.
$90,000 for reserve fund?
Seconded.
We voted that.
I think you voted that one.
No, we voted.
We did vote that.
Yeah, we voted it tonight, actually.
Yeah, and we did the Smith.
Yep. Okay, Article 20. Do we need to take a vote on that?
It's not monetary.
Yeah, we didn't...
I can explain it if you want, but...
We get...
We didn't circle any of those earlier today, so...
21. 22. Do we have any... Have we set aside any funds for operation and maintenance of that building once we get it? Nope.
No.
I think someplace along the way, we need to do that.
Yeah, what's it going to cost us?
It's not cheap. I'll tell you, the heat's probably going to be $15,000.
No, I mean, just structurally to get it up to snuff.
No idea. But we do need at least to have some sort of operational budget, I think. How much? We'll have to work on that, I guess.
Special. Article 21 is specific. We had this discussion last, the third, whether, how does Deerfield Academy get to build on town property?
Article 20.
Okay, Article 20 is, so it's repassed. So this is voting to change.
Yeah, we have, the town had accepted this land.
Yeah, I know. But I didn't, my question was, how does Deerfield Academy get to build on?
The board has the authority to do that.
They do.
It doesn't actually.
That went through town council?
Yes, it did. Because I did, I followed up with that. Do not need,
Any lease or any authorization?
They do not need town meeting approval to do this.
Release of liability, I'm sure, something like that. Release of liability if somebody gets hurt?
They'll take care of that. I mean, that's their responsibility to.
On town property, listen. If I get hurt on town property, what happens? That's it. I can't sue the town, right?
Can sue the town, but you can't get over $100,000.
That's right.
Don't get hurt bad.
I'm just saying, don't get hurt on the side of the building.
No, I did clear that with council.
Okay.
Okay. So that takes care of 22.
21?
That was 21.
Did you, I guess my comment would be, do we need to put emergency medical services in there? Or just leave out the medical in case somewhere down the road they have to find a bigger home or something? So.
Or we want to use the building for something else?
It leaves the.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It says a medical services. So are we narrowing the scope too tight in case?
Well, do you want to let the select board do anything they want? That's not what I hear usually from you.
No, that's not what you hear from us.
So if this narrows it to a very specific.
They could always vote.
I also understand.
They have to come back to do anything.
Yeah, they could vote again.
I mean, despite the fact that they have the authority, it's my understanding that this will be an annual lease or rental or something. Is that?
30-year. Not to exceed 30 years.
For a period not to exceed 30 years. So it could be 1 year.
Could be 1 year, could be 10. Whatever they agree to.
Okay. So there's nothing that we need to take up on 21, 22. What's 23?
What about 22? Why are we blowing over that?
We didn't. We talked about it.
We didn't vote.
What are we voting on?
Nothing.
It's a gift.
You can vote on it if you want. There's no money. You certainly can vote on it. There's no recommendation that is attached to it, I don't think.
What they should do is put a figure of 25 to 35,000 in there for anticipated maintenance, because you're going to have an electric bill, you're going to have an oil bill.
Yes.
You're going to have a water bill, and you're going to have a sewer bill, probably.
Mm-hmm.
Now, other than that, I don't know if they would move a telephone over there, what they would do, but.
What about?
At least 25 to 35 grand is something to start with.
What about getting the building up so it conforms to?
That's another issue.
Whatever it needs to conform to.
All of the services go right to that line.
Say again?
All the services go right to the line of where the building's going.
Right, but you're still going to pay your electric bill 12 times a year. You're still going to pay your oil bill.
Oh, yeah.
When they come in, or a gas bill if they have gas. I don't know what they have in there.
Oil. The moment.
And they still must have water if they're doing cooking in there.
The gas.
I don't know if they have bathrooms in there, but you probably got a sewer bill coming.
A propane.
Yeah. So we can't use the building, but we have to pay the bills until we.
Unless you want the thing to freeze up.
I wouldn't suggest that we.
No, me either. I think, I agree with you, John, I think we need somewhere.
They've got to put something in the budget for it somewhere.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think from all the conversation I've heard and discussion about this, I think that the board expects that they will have to get a handle on things and pretty quickly, you know, first of all, it has to be proved, and then they have to negotiate something, and then figure out what, you know, when, what, and how, so.
And you may have to use a reserve fund if you don't appropriate something.
I get concerned in that, you know, just. Well, yeah, but we didn't put it, don't have enough money in the reserve, we didn't put any extra in the reserve. And I would.
Town building maintenance.
And, you know.
Town building maintenance.
Well, I don't mind doing that a year from now, but for the moment, it would be nice to be able to say to the voters, here's what we anticipate the expenditures that we're going to make during the coming year. So is there any reason, you've got an article in there, is there any reason that we can't make that a monetary article?
I would want to do it, maybe a secondary motion perhaps, but I don't know.
Or, you know, if you get, I mean, if worse comes to worse, I suppose we could increase the reserve fund, but I don't like doing that if it's.
But it's not unforeseen.
The board wanted to.
The amount is.
Figure that out.
Right?
We could actually figure it out.
Well, once the building's built, yes, you can.
No, the building right now, we could tell, we could prorate the annual cost for next year. We would know how much it costs to operate that building for a year.
I mean, I would like to have that money, I guess you could make.
Plugging in $20,000 into town.
We could come up with a pretty close projection, I would think.
I would think so, too.
I'm sure they'd give you last year's expenses and divide by 12 and times whatever, however many months you got.
I agree.
Ken, where are we going to, where's the motion going to be?
In the town office building, in the omnibus, but for town office building maintenance.
So you want to increase?
That's what we.
Kind of, it was just a suggestion, because it would be a town building, and that would be where generally the maintenance would go for it.
That's not where the senior center.
No, their operating costs are in their budget, which is split then between the three towns.
Can't put in a senior center because that's shared by the three towns.
There's a lease.
It should go under town buildings, though.
But if it becomes a senior center, then.
If it becomes, then they will transfer it over, but we've got to determine what's going to be done for work before you can do it.
Everyone talks over you, please don't talk over me.
Is there a lease that the EMT, the medical building will have with the town?
The medical building, yes, I think that's what this article was.
That's what basically it is.
Yes.
No, that wasn't the article.
But I mean, there's not a monetary amount of money in that, just that there will be a lease.
It has been discussed. The monetary figure has been discussed. Been discussed.
Yes.
Several times, $36,000.
$36?
That was the number that was thrown out.
No, actually, it was discussed.
$54.
But this, but it.
Skim's meeting, and it was discussed at the Board of Selectmen meeting last meeting.
But it leaves it up to the Board of Selectmen to.
Set the dollar mark.
Put the dollar mark.
I think.
And they need to figure out how they're going to pay the maintenance and what they're going to use for improvements, or how they split that money. So we don't, at this point, we don't have.
Well, that's.
Any improvements.
Yeah, but we're going to, I agree, we're going to accept the gift.
So what do you think?
And find out we have to.
Well, I mean, you get, well, back to the church, but we've got, you know, the question does arise for the other one, too. We don't have it yet, so, in either case, so I suppose. In any event.
But not for the church, for the EMS.
Can we get the selectmen to put a budget together? Can we get Wendy to put the budget together?
Try again, but why don't we just, for now, put 20, I think that's a good idea.
I think we need to know what it's going to cost to make it
We need to have.
To conform to whatever building codes.
But if you do that, you're never going to get it done. It's going to be a year or 2 year project.
Well, suppose we accept the gift and we find out it's going to cost $500,000.
Well, I think that we discussed that the property was worth having it and we could.
Is it worth $500,000?
Because of the land.
It's not costing anything, just you could take the building down and create a parking lot.
Right.
All right, what's the cost to take the building down?
$30,000-$40,000.
Depending what's in there.
I know we don't want to do that.
No, I'm just saying.
You don't want to do that.
No, I know, but the worst case scenario.
Worst case scenario, right.
Absolutely, worst case scenario.
The only thing that I would say is if we don't do something with that building, take that building or acquire that building.
You don't have another chance.
Then the senior center is going to be placed where? What are we going to do with the senior center?
It's true.
If you move it anywhere, you're going to have to move it to Whately.
And the reality is that it shouldn't stay where it is.
Yeah, it can't stay where it is.
Well, it should have more room, but I don't have a problem letting it stay where it is.
I have a problem letting it stay where it is in the building, the condition of the building.
But it could go to Whately.
A lot of people that go there are elderly and they like antique buildings.
But it's not the antique building.
It's not the antique that they're worried about.
The one potential is that the building is actually older, so it really is an antique building.
I know that.
It just happens to be an antique building that's in better condition.
One way or the other, we have to accept this.
So we need to do something for with Article 22.
So will we just revote town building maintenance?
I think it needs to come back to the Finance Committee with some sort of, and I don't care where the money goes, but something, and then we need to vote it. Or recommend it or not recommend it, as the case may be.
Can we put it in as a warrant article?
It is.
Can't add.
It is.
No, the dollars.
I don't know.
We'll talk about that tomorrow and.
22A.
Yeah.
Okay. 23, what's 23?
New advertising mistake.
New England Bakers. Do we need to take any action on that?
Do you want an explanation of this?
Sure, why not?
As long as it's quick.
Well, it says it right there. This is just.
Oh, yeah.
They don't want to revote it, so they want to just let the legislature pass it. Rubber stamp our mistake. No problem.
Exactly. And we may not need to spend in touch with the governor's office. There may be the governor's filing that will take care of this before April 24th, and then we won't need to vote on this article.
So since it's not a money article, we ought to forget it.
Okay, I'm fine with that.
They're very interested in moving, in case you're wondering, full steam ahead and.
They have been for the last 2-3 years.
Well, they really are, right?
March 11th, 2015, that's two. Okay, so we don't need to take any action on this.
It's getting stale.
Article 24, just 24 and 25. They're really the same. Any questions on 24 and 25?
This is the new municipal modernization, which updated 30B to allow you for 5-year contracts, up to 5-year contracts used to be 3, whose value do not exceed 10.
And 10 used to be 4?
3.
3?
Yeah.
The 10,000 used to be.
I think it was 10,000, but it was 3 years.
Was it? Okay.
3 years, yeah.
So it doesn't fall 10 to 50 and 0 to 9999. There's no relationship in those two?
It can.
One's a.
It can, but this is just allowing them to.
But this is.
This is allowing $2,000, basically.
A dollar more than what the.
Oh, I see where you're going, yeah.
What they're authorized to do between 0 and 9999 is just quotes. They can go to whoever they want, best business practice. $10,000 to 50 is solicitation, low bidder. Scope, but low price.
It all bumped up and I'm right now not remembering.
I'm just concerned that.
What happens at 50?
$10,000 is probably not the right number. That's right.
You know, I wondered about that, but, you know, we've reviewed it over.
Okay.
We keep coming back to that. So it probably hooked into the five-year, you know, I don't know what.
Okay.
Like contracts, I'm trying to think what that was taking care of. That was a problem. Oh, I can look into that.
Postage meter or something like that, maybe?
So if we're not taking any action on it, then...
No.
Not taking any action, yeah.
No, we're not taking any action on Article 25. That's basically the, even though it is the...
Quinquennial.
Quinquennial, yeah, recertification. Okay. Article 26, to see if the town will vote to correct the layout. We don't need to take action there, I don't think.
No.
Okay, Article 27. That's the single tax bill for tax bills of $100 or less, as opposed to...
Two.
I don't think we have to vote on that either.
Don't think so.
It's just a policy. And the policy is if you got a $65 bill twice a year, and it, you send two $65 bills, if the total bill's less than $100, you pay it all at once up front.
Or in arrears and get an interest charge. How about the next one? 29, I don't think there's anything there.
28, you skipped. There's nothing there either, but...
Just superseded by the state procurement laws in this proposal.
29, 30.
Bruce St. Peters has made a couple of suggestions. The Capital Improvement Planning Committee wanted to make some changes to the wording of the bylaws that relates to CIPC. And that's what this Article 30 is referring to. Bruce saw them and has some suggestions that have value. So I guess it's the CIPC need, you know, we can go through and vote what CIPC wanted to do, and then next year vote again what Bruce is suggesting, or not. But
so I have no idea what it is. So
it's a more rigid definition of what should go to the CIPC, and basically it's that in a bunch of two or three articles. And Bruce wants to further refine that. And he's got some valid things, huh?
Suggested.
So I don't know. I hate to speak for the committee. We are a committee. Well, I'm the chairperson, but I don't make the decisions for it.
The committee make any decisions?
No, I found out about it today.
So a little late.
You need 2 days to post a meeting. So post a meeting.
No,
we're going to meet next
Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
A week from.
Is that the public hearing?
Does that
right
give?
Before the public hearing, they're
right
going
to
meet.
I don't think we'd have time. I don't know. Then we got a request.
Public hearings at 6:30.
Maybe I should move it to 5:30 if we're going to discuss these.
What?
Or should we just put it off a year?
Sounds good to me.
Well,
what's your thoughts, Jeff?
I don't think that's a bad idea because not too much is going to be restricted by not changing it during that time. And I'm hoping, as I've talked about with several people, including Bruce, that we can have the select board appoint a bylaw review committee to look at all the bylaws. As you can see, we're every town meeting, there's some change. Personnel board will work on those. Zoning will stay out of it, but all the general bylaws are pretty antiquated. They step us up at every turn, so you see lots of little changes. It's time to really take a look.
So,
you know, if the CIPC meets to discuss Bruce's suggestions, then we're going to be rushing through it again.
Right. Yeah.
And you know, I don't want to do that. So then it becomes. So do we want to put in what the CIPC wants this year, and then make more changes next year, or should we withdraw them and make them all next year?
Well,
that's what it boils down to.
I think there's some very important things that you want changed, and I think
but don't even need to wait a full year. I mean, if there's going to be a, I mean, you're going to have a special this year, we know that, you know.
But we don't. My feeling is that we could leave this as is for this year and review it.
Sometime during the year, if this is a special town meeting, and everybody's had a chance to get to.
To review the rest of it.
Or if not, do it next annual meeting.
Or.
That okay with you?
I don't, that's fine. I don't care.
This is why you have.
I don't care. I'm not part of the CIPC, so.
Well, all right. I appreciate your suggestions.
Okay, so we're gonna bypass this. We're not gonna take any votes on this. We're not gonna take any votes on 31, and we're not gonna take any votes on 32, right? So we've done, we're done. Do we need another meeting? We do need another meeting to talk about at some point in time. Some funding for Article, whatever it is. 21. 22. Okay, so I guess we'll have one other meeting between now and town meeting. Next Tuesday, if anybody have any problems next Tuesday?
I do.
I'll be in the Cape, so just start without me.
We'll wait for you though, okay?
There's a planning board meeting next Tuesday.
That's all right.
Monday's a holiday.
Monday's a holiday.
Right.
Yeah, you have a lot of people fighting in here next Tuesday. You better make it next Wednesday if you want.
Wednesday?
Tuesday's fine with me. I'm not meeting in the other room.
Yeah.
We won't be able to do it here, that's all.
Are we gonna do any reserve transfers until after the school year's over?
Don't have any yet.
We have a list that we're making. We'll put those together at some point.
So after June 30th?
No,
We need to do it.
Before after town meeting.
After town.
To try to fix some of them.
In May, early June, whatever. Okay.
Probably should do it the 18th because with the 19th, they're doing the town review and all that stuff.
We got the hearing too.
We have the.
Okay, what's the 18th? That's a Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Tuesday at 6:30.
I can't come.
You're lucky. Can I join you? Okay, anything else we need to talk about? We all set?
So what we'll do, Bruce, is we'll get to the annual meeting and then.
So the total budget?
Yeah.
Ask you to commit.
I just.
No.
I think you made some good points, but I think you're gonna go do it.
I agree.
I think after this. Something like that.
That's the old plan.
There may be a couple of changes that we throw in there, but.
That's last year.
So.
Yeah, I know.
Request that you commit.
$15,889.
Yeah, but that, I think.
So how do we do compared to last year?
Well, I might add.
What's that?
I think so. I think that's right.
Well, I might add $20,000.
Pardon? We might, yes, yeah.
What's the tax rate gonna be?
That's what I've asked her for that.
Ask the assessors.
You get the assessed values, right?
Yeah.
Do you get the grand list?
And that's not gonna, you won't get the.
You know, on a house, the tax rate would be.
That's the assessor's job.
I think, yeah, we asked Karen to do that, but I.
And that won't be done until next fall.
And you know how much money.
Well.
I mean, how much money you need.
Next fall.
Well, we could figure it out if we need the total grand list, right? We could say, yes, but they don't bother putting that together.
I think they're gonna tell you to go away and come back in 6 months.
Patriot Properties doesn't even assume.
Do we know what percent increase from last year?
What, valuation?
I can do the math. I didn't see the number.
I don't know what I have.
3.58%.
What, just the value of the real estate tax goes down?
Not the tax, no.
Well, when it hit '08, their price, hell, it took anywhere from 25% to 40%.
4% increase.
I'm pretty sure.
Total budget.
As a matter of fact, we're just about equal overall valuation where we were in '08, right at this point.
So that's why.
That's how far down.
But that's tax levy.
That's why the rates have gone up so fast, because you still have.
Taxes.
That's, well, that's
you know, you can go through the evaluation by 50%, which means your rate's gonna go up by 200%.
I was asking, from last year's total budget, this year's...
Oh, dollars a dollar, you know, if you're gonna, if you're not gonna change this over here.
Oh, I know, I got it.
Tax levy is 4%.
So, but I got it.
I don't know whether they have that or not.
I have it on one of these spreadsheets, it just doesn't print, I can't remember.
So what's, since the tax levy was 2% plus maybe a half a percent for new growth, the amount that's sitting in the warrant articles for...
I had a chart to show what the evaluation was, a bunch of years, must be my other folder.
What would change the, bump the tax levy higher than 3%?
The retired debt.
Yeah.
Off of the excluded debt.
What was the excluded debt last year?
I can't...
I thought the excluded debt had changed.
$100,000 more this year.
We did budget $100,000 for the school roof debt reduction. Looks like we had $384,000 for debt exclusion last year. This year it's $490,000, and the biggest difference is the school roof.
Okay.
Yep.
So it's the debt exclusion that's, okay?
Yes. No, you said debt exclusion, but it wasn't... That's not quite...
No.
What's that?
It's not the debt exclusion, so, you know...
That's the dollar garage, that's the payments.
Well, it was a voted debt exclusion.
A lot of money.
And the balance?
Yes, no, it was debt exclusion.
It was a debt exclusion. I was looking for increase in budget from last year to this year.
Oh, sorry.
Total budget.
Total budget.
To the Bakers.
Yeah. So three or four.
We're assuming revenues being similar to last year.
That's what we paid.
But we've got revenues that equal our budget, we saw that.
Yeah.
So $1 million, so we still...
$1 million in the hall.
Oh, I understand.
So after we sell, we're still $700,000 or $800,000.
But most of it driven by salaries.
Yeah, and, you know, as you know...
Most of the increases are driven by salaries.
And by what?
Salaries.
Oh, no.
No?
Yeah.
Oh, no, you, the only difference in the town's budget for salary between what the old... between fiscal 17 with just a COLA and what the new compensation plan is $21,889.
Yeah, I was talking school.
Yeah, but if you're talking all, I don't know.
Overall, right.
All the people I talk to say, perfect spot for seniors. I don't know how you feel about it, I said that. It's right in the middle of town, it's perfect.
Oh, I know.
I said that.
Substantial and small.
Should we make a motion to adjourn?
Yes, I think that would be appropriate.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
It's moved, seconded, take your pick. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.